Well, good afternoon to all of you, and welcome to the Force Broadcast. I am your host, Prophet, Assistant Chief Prophet, Angela Powers, and I'm so glad to be with you again this Wednesday. So listen, come on in and tell your friends that we are ready to just huddle together as praying people throughout the planet, as intercessors, as prophets, as apostles, and to confer on the mind of God, what he's disseminating in this time concerning prayer and intercession. So we welcome you back this Wednesday. And as we prepare to dive in again this week, I'm going to try something here. You know, so often I have these slides that I have here for you guys, wanting to share with you and wanting to show you. So I'm going to work on here today your ability to see these. Now, do let me know in the comments if you join. Good afternoon. Let me know in the comments if, as I'm sharing the slides today, if you notice that it creates any type of an extra lag for the connection or what have you. Let me know that in the comments so that I'll know for the future to troubleshoot that a little more. But we're going to give it a try today so that you all can see the slides even more clearly. So welcome. We have been in our War College theme. We've been talking about the fact that God is marching upon the cosmos, right? We've been discussing his making of the case of intercession. And we've been talking about how scripture tells us in Exodus 15:3 that the Lord is a man of war. The Lord is a man of war, and the Lord is his name. And so we've discussed that, one of the attributes with which he is causing us to know him in this era is as a man of war. And so as he is doing such, raising up in where we are at in the sovereign divine world war cycles, we've been discussing that as we prepare for the battles that are ahead, as we prepare for the wars that are part of this era, we've been discussing the soldier versus the warrior. And talking about how many of us are warriors, but many of us are not soldiers. And that if you're just speaking generically, if you're just speaking in layman's terms, then you might think, well, what's the difference? What's the big deal? But when you get into professional research, when you get into the terms for when you're talking about people who are experts, that there is a distinction, that the soldier has been trained, has studied, has developed on a much broader and sophisticated scale, and it enables the soldier to have a whole nother level of professionalism, expertise, responsibility, and common connection with the other members of their unit. And so in this era, we need that kind of a mind. We need that army of the Lord. It's one of the revelations and messages that we've kind of heard over the stretch of the last 10 years. And it's time to really assess ourselves as we've now entered into the new era as to how much of that army we have become, what's left for us to, develop into, what's left for us to shift, what's left for us to revamp and restructure, what's left for us us to change individually and collectively as those that God is gathering and summoning for the things that he is facing, for the overthrow of his enemies, plots, plans, and purposes. This is a season and this is a time where every conspiracy against God is being overthrown. We're in that kind of era. And with that kind of era comes shakings. With that kind of era comes all kind of unexpected turns. With that kind of era is where you hear things like what the scripture says when it says, once more and again, I will shake the heavens and the earth. It's a heaven and an earth shaking time when God raises up off of his throne as the man of war to go to battle. It's a heaven and an earth shaking time when God begins to gather and summons his people into the army of the Lord, posture and position, and they begin to march and go into their formations and prepare for war. And so we're in that kind of season. We're in that kind of time. That's why, you know, you turn on your news, you see all the jokes and the memes and the challenges, even about this year, 2020, because there seems like it's constantly something else and something else and something else, because we're in that kind of time. And so for us to be ready to respond to what God is doing in this time, we need that shift. From the warrior to the soldier, to not just be warriors, but to become developed, trained, refined, matured into the military mindset and the military consciousness of a true soldier. The Bible said what? Endure hardness as a good soldier. So the scripture is filled with examples and languages of this particular aspect and dynamic in the life of the kingdom citizen, of the new creation citizen. And so we've been making contrast and talking about the forging of the military mind, where your mind is not just in this era where the tactics are only. And many times we can get, you know, very caught up in teaching tactics, but the consciousness that you have, the mindset that you have, is what will drive how you execute the tactics that you learn. And there is a consciousness shift that is so imperative for us in this time. And as we make that cognitive shift, we become better at really aiming the targets of this climate, the targets of these conditions, the targets of this war, and the targets of this era. Thank you, Jesus. And so we've been talking about that, and we're kind of going through a series really that's doing that for us, that's confronting us, that's making us think about how we look at, how we approach, how we assess internally and externally, and forge and bring your mindset for war and for battle into another dimension, into another place, into the station, as my chief apostle has stated in our global apocalyptic prayer project packet, into the station, the standing, the status, and the stature that this era and these kind of wars that we are facing requires. So we understand, right, a simple scripture like, know ye not that ye are not your own, but you've been bought with the price. Know ye not that you are the temple of the Holy Ghost, and the power of the Holy Ghost dwells in you. Now, I challenged you on last episode that when you read that, you would not just hear that with your traditional ears, with your ecclesial ears, with your religious ears, but that you would hear that with ears that are monarchical ears, that are governmental ears, that understand the stratas of being under a king and under a sovereign. And so with that, we talked about how that power of the Holy Ghost in you is an instrument of national power. That it is not only the, you know, we talk a lot, we personalize the gospel a lot, we personalize Jesus a lot, we personalize our relationship with God a lot, and there is indeed a personal dimension. He is our Father. Yes, we are part of the family of God, but the entirety of the revelation of our identity, and especially when we start talking about war, and especially when we start talking about being soldiers in the army of the Lord and the consciousness of the battles that are ahead of us. We're no longer just talking about the family. When is the last time that you read in your history books about some war that unfolded in the nations and you saw mom and dad and the two little kids out setting up a table to have dinner in the middle of the war and watch the war? War is not a domestic sphere. War is not a place for civilians, right? When you read about the history books or you watch some movie that's reenacting the climate and the conditions of war, matter of fact, one of the things that are strategic about war that many times soldiers and battalions and platoons have an assignment to do is to actually remove civilians from places that are high level for a fallout, for battle, for attack, to protect civilians, because really the protocols of diplomacy is such that when you see those kinds of dynamics between nations in the record of history, but the fair war diplomatic protocol is such that they're not to engage civilians, but that there are specific terrains, specific territories where battle is to be executed and civilian populations are to not be brought in the midst. And so even when you study the history of so many things, some of the worst battles, the worst wars, some of the wars that are the most recorded in history are the ones that brought great deficit to the civilian populations of nations. So war and civilian, come on here, does not go together, which means when you begin to embrace and enter into this whole dynamic of the army of the Lord, intercessors, prophets, you are not entering this as a civilian. You cannot bring the domestic mind. You cannot bring the domestic consciousness to this. You see what I'm saying? You've got to shift into another mind. And that's why we've had a lot of fatality, we've had a lot of losses, we've had a lot of gains that were short-term gains where we experienced pushbacks and regressions, because we have warred in many regards as domestics. We have warred with the civilian consciousness of the kingdom. But I heard the Bible say that ye are kings and priests unto our God. And a king has to think about more than just the civilian sphere, domestic enjoyment, luxuries. The king has to think about how he maintains his domain, how he expands his domain, how he secures his domain. And so kings have to think with the mind of defense, with the mind of military execution. Right? And so there's this other mind that the Spirit of the living God is challenging us concerning, as we would be those that would pray, intercessors and prophets. And so the Holy Ghost in us, that's not just, you know, our personal relationship with the Holy Spirit. It's an instrument of national power. When we execute, when we impart, when we release virtue, when we move by something we say, the Holy Ghost said, these are instruments of national power. When we take on certain titles and say that we're a prophet this, an apostle that, we have to take that seriously. We have to take the responsibility of that seriously, because when we step into the offices, we become agents of that national power. We become agents, representatives of the nation. When an ambassador goes to another country, they are there as if the very commander and chief and lead of that nation is there, which means whatever they say and whatever they do is an act of the nation. It represents an act of the nation, a statement of the nation, a decision of the nation. So they have that kind of consciousness. They can't go, to another, to Beirut, like they're there as a civilian on a vacation, looking at beaches and enjoying the sun. They got to go as this embodiment and this representative of the national power and the national influence that they represent. You see what I'm saying? And so now the apostles are the full embassy ambassadorial embodiment of that. That That's why the Bible tells us first apostles, but then as kings and priests unto our God, we serve in different measures of also representing God. Prophets also, when you look at definitions like in the Prophet's Dictionary, it talks about the spokesperson of a deity. Okay, so at different ranks, lower ranks than the apostles, we begin to come in as representatives of the kingdom that we serve. So we can't have this personalized consciousness only. We can't have this my personal Jesus consciousness only and engage in prayer, engage in intercession, engage in targeting the things, the issues, the circumstances that are emerging in your families, in your ministries, in your neighborhoods, in your cities, in your state, your region, and your nations, without really making a remold into this kind of consciousness. And so that's a corporate thinking. Saying, God, the Holy Ghost in me is an instrument of national power, is corporate thought. And soldiers, see, warriors think individually. I'm anointed, and the anointing of the Lord came upon me. Soldiers think corporately, instrument of national power. Okay, and so we talked about that, and the whole issue of the adversary and his threats of violence, the kingdom suffering violence, and the violent take it by force. And the need for us to begin to assess, we said on last episode, the strong man, to assess his will, to actually execute threats that he's making, to assess capabilities, and to assess our vulnerabilities. And so as we're speaking about this consciousness that we need to come into, we are understanding that the lack of this consciousness is a vulnerability. We're discussing this in part because it is currently one of our vulnerabilities in the kingdom of God. And so making the ship on our behalf brings us into another level of defense, so that the violence that the adversary would attempt to execute against our throne would not be successful. Right. And so we're clear that the adversary has a measure of capability. But the Bible said, behold, I give you power over all the power, over all the capability of the enemy. Now, there's two different Greek words there for power. We're not studying that verse today. I'm mentioning it in passing. But he said, I give you authority over all of the ability of the enemy. I give you exousia over all of the dunamis of the enemy. Okay. And so just in terms of this assessment, right, that there are capabilities there. He's given us a capability over his capability. But if our vulnerabilities are great, you see what I'm saying? Then now we affect the fact that we've been given a power over all the power of the enemy, because our weaknesses make us susceptible to the power of his capabilities. You know, we talked about the importance of our will as we're making the shift in the way that we think, then a part of that is the will. When we're assessing a threat, we talked about assessing what will does your adversary have to execute the threat that they are making, and then vice versa. When the disciples said to Jesus, Lord, teach us to pray, and after this matter, pray ye. We talked about our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, what? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. So we understand that the will of God is central to the executions of intercession, of prayer and of intercession. And so the intercessor, the prophet, those that would take on employees of prayer have to conform their will to his will, to the will of God. And oftentimes what we are seeing is that we're willing to pray our understanding of his will. But when that will comes, because we said what? That kingdom come, that will be done. When the kingdom begins to come in and begins to operate in the things that need that must unfold for the will to be done, we can oftentimes, in our ignorance, in our naivete, in our gullibility, in our pride, in our carnality, right, our fleshiness, not identify that this is actually heaven coming, the kingdom coming, heaven responding to what we've been lifting up and crying out and asking asking God to do. There's so many things that are going on in the planet right now that the church is warring against because it hasn't identified what aspects and components are answers to the things that it has been crying out for. Now, when that happens, we are at risk of having a constricted will, which is what you see here in the slide. In Luke 13:34, it says, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, which killest the prophets and stonest them that are sent unto thee. How often would I have gathered thy children together as a hen doth gather her brood under her wings, and ye would not." Your will would not conform to the way that I wanted to gather you, to the way that I wanted to shelter you, to the way that I wanted to nurture you and nourish you and bring you up in strength against the plaques of your enemies, okay? And so they had a constricted will. Now, as praying people, when we have this constriction upon our will, then we become those that entangle, become a part of entangling the actual execution of his will. The Matthew 6:10-13 that we just referred to, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in the earth as it is in heaven." So unwilling intercessors send the breakthrough backwards. Unwilling intercessors create impediments, because as God begins to manifest, as God begins to move in, they are pushing back. Their lack of understanding is pushing back. Their ignorance is pushing back. Their carnality is pushing back. And all of these are governed, shaped, guided, steered by what's going on with the mind, by what consciousness you're sitting in, by what's going on with the spirit of your mind. All of that is what's steering your responses. And so we need to understand that when we say thy kingdom come, that means that there's space. We begin to kind of open this up and discuss this. There's an issue of us needing to make space. If our will is constricted, we're saying to God that there is no space, or there's very little space for what you're trying to do. There's very little space for what it is that needs to operate, that needs to be executed to actually respond to the things that I'm asking you about, the things that I'm lifting up in prayer, the things that I'm crying out to you about. And so let's dig into this whole issue of space more this afternoon. So what is space? Well, first I want to start with the scientific definition. Scientifically, they say that space is the three-dimensional representation of everything we observe and everything that occurs. Pay attention to that first part. It is the three-dimensional representation of everything that we observe, okay? So we're talking about materialization. Space is how the things we are observing have materialized themselves. So when we talk about intercessors' will needing to be broken enough and surrendered enough and conformed enough and clear, their consciousness and cognition clear enough about what the will of God is, that is, those are space creation protocols. You see what I'm saying? Those are the things that make room for God, so that when we sing our worship songs, you know, "Lord, I want more of you. Give us more, so much more, God." You know, when we sing our worship songs, those are the space creation protocols that actually create a place for God to be able to respond to what we are asking him for. And that has a material form, that has physical realities. That's more than just some kind of, you know, sentimental feeling that you have in your heart that, "Oh God, yes, I just want you so much. Yes, I open up my heart to you." You know, these are sentiments. You feel like you want God until he shows up and says, "But that relationship is what's blocking my space. And so I gotta cut that relationship out of you." And when God begins to deal with those material realities, That's oftentimes where the affront comes up in the soul of the intercessor, comes up in the soul of the praying person, and then there's an impediment to relinquishing yourself to the very thing that you've been asking God to do. Or there's a shift in the finance, right? You're living real comfortably. You got a nice situation going on. You know, you got a nice situation of what you got in the bank account, and then God says, but I need this to happen. I need you to actually move from where you currently live to this other place. And then you find out when you try to make this move, you're not going to get the money that you've established for yourself where you are. Material. You're in a particular city. You have established a particular network of how you do what you do that has brought you into a particular realm of supply, physical, literal dollars, money that you can engage to do the thing. You built an entire life. You got a particular home. You got particular furnishings. You got particular food. You drive a particular car. You wear particular clothes. And now the Lord talking about he want this thing over here. And if you do this, you're researching, because first you got excited. Okay, that's what I'm a little nervous for. But yes, Lord, until you began to see what the material shift would be. And you begin, oh my God, so if I go here, my income is about to go down $10,000 a year. And then that means I'm going to have to adjust some things with what I wear or what I drive or what house what my living environment will be when I get into this environment, at least for a season until however, whatever way that this can be rebuilt back up to what I've known. Now there's, well, I don't know if that's God. I mean, God gave me this job here and God gave me favor. And I can remember what I was asking God. Now you don't know if it's God, because the collision that it is making with your material reality and your affection. Come on, hear what I'm saying. Your affection for your material reality is causing you now to second guess, double mind, pedal back, and harden your will, constrict your will against, is this you? Is this God? Is this what really needs that? So you've been crying out. And the significant thing about us is that you will literally go back into your prayer room the next day, the rest of the week, and you'll continue to cry out for the things you've been asking God for concerning his kingdom, his will, revelations of his scripture of truth, and not make the connection that this is where he's asking you to make space so that the kingdom can come, so that the triggers and the progression and the prophetic process of how that will come to be can begin to come in place. So when we talk about, you know, space and talk about the fact that God is moving into the planet, you see, that when we ask him to do these things, when we say, Lord, we need your kingdom to come. That we're talking about our need for God to move into the planet. Please excuse my throat there for a second. Okay, and so let me just having a little my mouse has. Okay, yes, thank you. All right, and so we're talking about this whole issue. Now, as we discuss this, as we begin to talk about making this space and beginning to better able to see that in our lives, let's look at Joseph, because I think Joseph is a precedent, right? Joseph is a case study that we can use. It's one of the reasons why intercessors, we really have to know the word of God. We have to stay engaged with God's word. We have to make it a part of our fiber. We have to really eat the book, you know, as he said to the prophets, intercessors, apostles. We have to know the word. We have to eat the book, because one of the things we're doing is it's not just to know the word religiously and to just recite the word, you know, and just say, well, the word says this or the word says that. It is so that we can do the research that identifies God in the now for us, that identifies where the fingerprints, the DNA, the precedents, and the protocols of God are appearing in our own life, in our own circumstances, in our own situations. Okay, so that's imperative. So let's look at Joseph. Joseph is a sample for us. Joseph is an example of someone we could look at in scripture concerning this. Now, when we talk about Joseph, we know, and we can, we know that Joseph was in a family, right? He was in this domestic sphere. He's the son of Jacob. He's favored by his parents. This favor from by his parents, it affects his relationship with his brothers. There's jealousy, there's envy there, which turns into them actually dropping him into a pit one day and then selling him to slave traders. These slave traders do what? That circumstance does what? It moves Joseph out. Moves Joseph out of the material place where he was at, his material reality. The fact that he was with his parents, with his brothers, had a certain life, lived in a certain land, acclimated to a certain set of things in how, you know, the culture of how they did things. And all of a sudden, induced by the jealousy of his brothers, his material reality changes. But when we say induced by the jealousy of his brothers, we're really talking about the human level of this. We're really talking about the earth view. Because we understand, because he makes a testimony of it later in the scriptures, that as this began to unfold, this wasn't just human activity. This was sovereign providential shifts. So this material shift in his circumstances really wasn't induced as much as it was carried out by their issue of jealousy. But it was really a providential schematic that was unfolding because of what God was setting up, which is why later in scripture, Joseph testifies and says, you know, in so many words, he's forgiving his brothers for what they've done. And he said, but you know, this was God that did this so that many would be saved alive. God was the one that needed me to be here so that he could save many, many lives. And he's referring to the famine and the national plan that God presents to Pharaoh and is able to put into action and oversee and save many peoples of many lands through this famine. Okay, so look at all the, we know the story of Joseph. We know that not only did they give him to these slave traders who take him into this other nation in Egypt, but then he's in Potiphar's house, right? He gets favor because he's a person of excellence. He's serving well. So Potiphar puts him over everything in his house. And then what happens? God's providential schematic has not reached the fullness of what God needs for the will that Joseph saw in dreams to be made manifest. Now, come on. You think of put yourself in that, that you think about the dreams and the visions and the insights that you've had as the Holy Spirit, that national instrument has, of power has visited you, that not just about your personal self and your personal realities, but about the kingdom, right? And when you had those dreams, when you saw those visions, you received those revelations and insights, you're praying those things. Like Daniel, remember he saw the vision. The Bible says that Daniel was troubled about the vision. So he began to pray because he wanted understanding, right? They hit us different ways, but you go into prayer, whether it's because you need more understanding, you went into prayer, maybe because you're like, okay, God, you show me this wonderful thing now concerning your kingdom, and now I'm praying it into the earth. And imagine yourself going through a disruption, like the level of what Joseph went through. We've gone through that, right? But many times, we do see from the planetary level. All we can see is what we think someone has done to us. And so in the circumstance, think about the ways that you constricted your will against what it was that God was executing, against what it was that God was doing. And think about how you began to, way or another, essentially push back rather than yield to it, rather than yielding and allowing God to bring your understanding up to the sophistication of the fact that this is me making space. This is me materializing how this prayer will come into manifestation. These are the stages and the protocols and the precedents that will birth what you saw back there. You see, Joseph had to reach that place. And so God's assessing Joseph. Come on here. And he's in Potiphar's house, and he says, but first of all, I haven't fully brought what I showed you into being. Second of all, you still don't see it yet. So then he allows Potiphar's wife, right, to have this lust, this desire to make this accusation that now, okay, Joseph has stabilized himself in this material reality of being a slave in Potiphar's house, but having this favor of being over everything. And as soon as he's kind of stabilized himself, though I'm sure he was aching and missing his homeland and missing his family and missing his domestic realities. Come on, somebody. Another shift happens, and now he's in the prison. The material reality shifts again because God is making space, because God, he couldn't stay in Potiphar's house and get the connection the way God had providentially laid it out to unfold. He needed to be in the prison because Potiphar's house, listen, it's not just about, you know, the drama of it, you know, the drama. Dragging him through trauma and just seeing Joseph, do you love me? Potiphar's house was not giving Joseph access to palace connections. I'm going to say it again. When God makes space, right, it's a 3D representation, material representation. People are material representation. They're one of the things that is a material representation. In Potiphar's house, Joseph was not giving access to palace connections. So his material reality had to be shifted again, because even though the prison was worse, the palace was there. Come on and hear what I'm saying. Even though the prison was worse, the palace was there. God had a scenario where he had created space for and the opportunity that would manifest the vision that and the dreams that were all the way back from childhood. So Joseph finds himself in an even worse material reality, right, in order to for this to manifest. Now let me shift your mind some more, right, because we understand this story from the lens of Joseph, right, and many times we put ourselves in Joseph's place, you know, to kind of think about things that we've gone on in our life. Now let me shift you again. Let's go to Matthew chapter 1 verses 1 and 2, and let's give you another even yet another angle on this. Matthew chapter 1 verses 1 and 2. Matthew 1 is the chapter on the genealogy, right, of Jesus Christ. So 1 and 2 tells us, speaks to us concerning the segment of the generations that Joseph would have been in. It says, the book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Judas and his brethren. Joseph was included in the brethren of Judas. So it's mentioning Joseph there when it says that Jacob begat Judas and his brethren. And Judas begat Pharaoh. Well, I'm stopping at verse 2. So now, if you don't have the book Before the Garden that my chief apostle has written, I recommend you need to go get this book. It's an amazing book on the continuum, and you want to know what that means, you need to get the book, where she talks about how the God's reality is a continuum. And if we know the continuum and we study the continuum, we understand the continuum, this is also what helps us be able to discern the true Jesus Christ from so many of the other Christ and so many of the other gospels that we're presented with in our culture, climate, and time. Okay, so within this idea of the continuum, one of the things that she discusses in that book is how God used the prophets to bring Jesus Christ into the planet. The prophets, as they would connect with God, as they would be his spokesperson, as they would release the word of the Lord into each generation and segment of time, all of the words that they were releasing were things that were about setting up and preparing the way for Christ to come. Okay, when the prophets are talking to Israel, when different things are, think about Samuel, right, going to Jesse's house, which if you read on, David is one of the main figures of the genealogy list, and it talks about Jesse giving birth to David. Okay, but Samuel, now let's look at the prophetics of it. was the one as a prophet who had to go into a home and be able to identify the one that God was putting his anointing on, because that was a part of the blocks, the building blocks of what was bringing Christ into the planet. That person was a material in a representation of how God was making space to shift himself from his eternal form into a divine God-man form and come into the planet. So each of these genealogy, generational stages were building blocks, were and the stories, the things that happened, all were unfolding and bringing Christ into the planet. So even when we look at Joseph's story, at Joseph, what happens? God shifting Joseph into Egypt was about the fact that Israel, Jacob was renamed Israel. Israel had to be shifted from just being a family, just being a tribe, to becoming a nation, because out of that nation would come the continuing lineages and monarchies that are all part of what needs to be paved in the way for Christ to come to the planet. Jesus would sit on what? The throne of David, as it concerns of the human monarchical legacies. It's scripture said that he was of the throne of David. So if a nation never got here, and then if a David never got here, then you see, we're messing with the schematic. We have holes in the schematic of what is bringing Christ into the planet. And so Joseph, this all this stuff Joseph was going to was not only about the materialization of that personal impact and effect of a vision that was shown him, but God was speaking to him about how he was shifting his family from just being a family and tribe to being a nation. It was in Egypt that the Bible tells us that Israel multiplied, that they became a great people. And then it says, and there arose not a Pharaoh that what? That knew not who? Joseph. You see what I'm saying? And then this is when we began to have the ship that opens up the way for Moses. But before we get to that, Joseph needed to be materially shifted in all of these ways. Through all of this transition, through all of this trauma, so that Israel could be put into a position, Jacob and his family could be put in a position to be now built up and multiplied from just being a tribe to being a nation, because the nation was carrying Kande Robo Sebai Nandebos Mikaya. The nation was carrying the next measure of manifestation of the will of God. Glory to your name, Jesus. And so when we think, read that story about Joseph, and even when we relate to it, we often don't think about that. Sorry, my computer over here. We often don't think about that. We often do not think about the ways in which we often don't think about that aspect of it, that national level, that broader kingdom element that's being brought into materialization, that broader way. So the things that you are walking through are not just only about how God is materializing your personal vision, as we would say. They are also about how God is materializing his national campaign. They are about how God is materializing the kingdom. They are about how it is that when we cry out and say, thy kingdom come, that thy kingdom is actually coming, taking on physical form, taking on embodiment, having a body. What did the prophet say concerning Jesus? He said, a body you have prepared for me, right? Because it's the significant element between those supernal realities and the way that they manifest on the planetary and creational scale. Okay, so we kind of don't think about that oftentimes when it comes to Joseph. And this is the mind that we've got to get when we look at these things. This is the kind of mind that we have to begin to shift into. That soldier's consciousness, that's thinking corporately. That's not just looking at, that's part of the reason why you can't identify Jesus. That's part of the reason why you end up acting Pharisaic against your own intercession and the intercession of the church at large and the way that God is answering the kingdom at large. We want to act like being a Pharisee is about somebody telling you that the length of your skirt should be such and such, or about somebody telling you to cover up your breast crack, which you do need to cover up. But come on here, somebody, no. The Pharisees could not identify the word made flesh. The Pharisees, Jesus rebuked them and said, listen, you'd have been all through the scripture and can't identify it when it's standing in front of you. Woe unto us as a people in this era and this time. Woe unto us as intercessors and praying people, that we would cry out to heaven to do things, that we would cry out to God for answers that we cannot perceive. When they began to enter and take up space, when they began to materialize and come into their physical form. So this is something we've got to change. The soldier thinks corporately. The soldier thinks about the national power. The soldier thinks also about the national sense. And when you depersonalize, then you become more objective. You see what I'm saying? When you depersonalize, a lot of the things that you're walking through, you can be more objective. When you have more information to see it from the national schematic, and I'm talking about as a kingdom, as the kingdom of God, talk about the spiritual, eternal nation of Jesus Christ as articulated in scripture. I'm not talking about natural nations right now. When you see it from that spiritual entire national schematic, right? It helps you also to be more objective, yeah? So that your traumas and your feelings and your dysfunctions are brought out of it a little more. We need that as intercessors. We need that as praying people. So we have to do what? Let this mind be in us. We have to let this mind be in us, which was also in Christ Jesus. If we can get the soldier's mind, if we can get this military mind, not just the warrior's mind that flares up and kicks back and gives certain responses, but if we can get this soldier's mind, it can help us to really be able to identify these things more readily. It will help us to compute differently, to compute what is unfolding with the will of God. Now, Prophet Angela, Assistant Chief, what do you mean when you say that it can help us to compute differently? Because when we begin to talk about this whole thing of God coming into the planet, when we're talking about this aspect of our intercessory execution that requires us to make space and to understand how these processes and protocols work in relation to the manifestations of the things that we're going to cry out for, we have to understand that there's calculations involved in that. There's an ability to identify and to break down and to see certain things. And so let's think about, I love the scripture in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12. You guys know this verse. Hebrews 4 and 12 is in the King James, for the word of God is powerful, it is living, it is effective, it is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, bone and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. The word for word, okay, for the word of God is quick or living. The word, the Greek word for word is logos, right? Logos. Now, when you look at logos, the definitions, part of those definitions are words like reckoning and account, that the word actually means account or accounting or reckoning. As a matter of fact, the Young's literal translation takes that same verse in Hebrews 4:12 in the King James. It says the word of God is quick and living, sharper than any two-edged sword, and it translates it this way. It says, for the reckoning of God is quick and sharper than any two-edged sword. It actually distinctly pulls out that word reckoning in that translation. It says, for the reckoning of God is living. That's how it says it in the Young's literal. For the reckoning of God is living and sharp above every two-edged sword and piercing unto the dividing asunder of both soul and spirit, of joints also and marrow, and a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. So when we begin to talk talk about reckoning, we move into this aspect of the word being calculative, being computative, being like a program, okay, in that particular sense. So the word of God, the word reckons, it computes, it accounts, it calculates, it installs a program into the thing that it is sent to. You remember Isaiah 55? What did he say? He said, you know, my thoughts are above your thoughts, even as the heavens are above the earth, so are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts are above your thoughts. And then he begins to talk about as the rain come down from heaven, it waters the earth, and it makes it to bud, you know, so that there's food for the eater and seed for the sower, bread for the eater, seed for the sower. He says, so shall my word be. Then what did he say? He said, it shall not return unto me void, but what? It shall accomplish the thing that I say, what? In the thing whereunto I sent it. Context clue. There in the scripture. So the word literally goes to things and literally goes into things, which means that it's like installing a program on a device, and that it literally installs itself into the thing that the word is sent to. When you and I are praying, when we're interceding prophets, you already know, come on, when we're praying, when we're sitting for the Lord, the word of the Lord, prophesying, etc., we are sending a word to a thing. We're sending a word to, you know, the people that are involved in circumstances. We're sending a word if there's a tumor in a brain and someone says, I need you to pray for my husband. He's been diagnosed with this tumor. Well, that word is going to that thing. So now we got to think about that more than just, again, our kind of religious, you know, like, yes, you know, we see it in that spiritual aspect, but now think about it in this sense that the word is laying out for you. So if the word installed, if it is a word that is truly from his mouth, that is set in the proper chironics or timings of God, okay, it goes into, literally installs itself into the physiology of this person that needs this healing, and it literally begins to compute. How else could God's word heal if it's not able to do things like compute hormonal shifts, compute size, compute the things that doctors are getting on the computer and running the test as humans to know the intelligence of the power of the Holy Ghost encapsulized in a word? I'm saying something to y'all today. I don't know. Listen, I don't even normally say nothing about no cash out, but some of y'all, listen, need to really just go on and sow a seed today to the cash out prophet Angela after the broadcast. So listen, you send them the word, and that word is, it's his word. It's him. It's intelligent. It's the, as my chief apostle, it's the logic and not just the rhema of God. And so it's going in and it's literally calculating to manifest what the word has said, which is heal, right? To literally calculate for the, whether that thing, if it's, say, for example, it was a cancerous tumor, right? Then you're dealing with particular types of cells that are foreign, that are attacking this body, that need to be obliterated. The power of God in that word is calculating for that. In the physiology, it's reckoning the various elements of things. Now, the process of how that looks is different for different people, right? For some people, it's miraculous healing. For some, you know, instantaneous. For some people, it's progressive. For some people, it requires the cooperation of natural interventionists, that the sovereign hand is maneuvering and guiding and steering, right? It's different. That's a whole other lesson, right, that we can get into in terms of that. The point is that when we begin to talk about this mind, and we're talking about this consciousness, and we're talking about this sophistication that belongs to the soldier and not just to the warrior, then we understand that the word of God does this, that it computes, that it calculates, that it reckons. And so we have to learn how to do that, you know, not just to pray and ask God for things and say, thy kingdom come, but to have enough of the scripture of truth, and to be so, let me change that language, to be so full of the scripture of truth that we can compute, we can calculate, we can reckon, we can identify the way that that thing is materializing so that we can continue to cooperate intercessionally, interventionally, etc., with what is. Some of us as intercessors, we prayed a certain prayer for years, but the problem is that intercession has now reached the point of something that must be done, but you don't know what to do. So many times we talk about, we reference the sons of Issachar, right? In scripture, it says that they knew the times and knew what Israel ought to do. Too many of us as intercessors have a knowledge of what's going on in the spirit. We have revelatory insight. And this is also why intercessors have to partner with prophets and apostles. This is why this is not an isolated, independent thing, but this is a military formation. These are platoons and battalions, and we have to be formed and organized and collaborative in ways that are far more effective than what we've done up to this point. Nevertheless, you know, when we're dealing with this, when we're talking about that, part of being able to compute, part of being able to identify, part of being able to assess what's going on is to be able to then know what to do. And so some of us, we've prayed enough to have a lot of revelation about a lot of things, but we don't know what to do. So now intercession is at the point where it needs to shift into its other dimensions, right? Because intercession is not just prayer, right? And some of the intercessors are at a point where they need to all go up to intervention, but you don't know what to do. Think about Joseph. He had a plan. When he finally reached the place that God had been creating all of this space, making all these material changes in his material reality to get him to that point, when he stands before Pharaoh, he knew what to do. He knew how to take what, not just tell Pharaoh, well, this is what the dream means. He knew how to execute the revelation. He knew how to execute the intelligence that the dream had installed into this global, at that time, Pharaoh would essentially been a national and essentially global ruler because of the rank of Egypt in the planet, okay? Like when they say that the U.S. presidents, someone referred to, they'll say it, the head of the world, leader of the world, leader of the free world. They're just simply saying that they're talking about national ranks. They're talking about hegemonic power. Look it up, H-E-G-E-M-O-N-I-C, hegemonic powers. Okay. And so nevertheless, that's not what we're talking about succinctly and exactly today. But we're referring to Joseph. Okay. So you understand this. We need to now shift and come into this mind that Christ had, that is more about just the visions, more about just the dreams, more than just the revelations and the insights, though we need those. But now is the logic of God, the logos of God, the accounting, the reckoning, the calculating, the computating, the programming of how this is coming to be, so that we're more cooperative. Let me ask you this question. As we get ready to go out, you see the slide here that says imagineering or interceding. Can I ask you that? Are you imagineering or interceding? Let's read the verse. It's you're familiar with this verse, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through, I can't remember if that's 5 or 6, but for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought into the obedience of Christ. Okay, so we understand that intercession is one of the components in the overall mechanisms of war and how God does war. It's not the end all be all, right? Again, that's why intercession has to be connected to a prophetic process, has to be connected to an apostolic model. That's why intercessors need to be connected with prophets, need to be connected with apostles, right? It's not an end all be, it's not in and of itself. It's not just pray and okay. Okay, there's an entire thing. It's a part of the mechanization. There's so much I can say about that, but it's a part of the mechanization of the overall machine of how God is executing and bringing his kingdom to be into the planet. Okay, and so this is putting that us in that warfare context here in 2 Corinthians 10, and it's saying, okay, we walk in the flesh, we're human, we're living in the physical world, we don't war after the flesh, we don't use carnal weapons. That's a whole, right? Y'all know that's a whole other teaching, breaking down the whole issue of the carnal weapon. But what we do use is mighty to God. And then he said it has an aim, that this might, this instrument of national power, because might is also an instrument of national power. He said it has an aim. And he says that aim is that we would pull down strongholds and that we would cast down imaginations. Now, intercessors, when you don't have this mind in you, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. That's the this mind I'm referring to, the mind that was also in Christ Jesus. When you don't have this mind in you, you are susceptible to being fertilized with the imaginations of God's adversaries. And you're susceptible to being shifted out of interceding to imagineering, which is helping build the images of the adversarial nation, right? Helping build and give rise to. That's why we got so much darkness sitting in the seats of power. Come on here. The darkness loves to hijack rooms. Do you understand what I'm saying? See, Satan had his own plan in the tree. When he was in the tree working to seduce Adam and Eve, he had an entire plan about how he was going to roll out his rule over the creation, how he would roll out his rule through humanity. All he needed was a birther. I can't get nobody to say nothing to me. I don't know if y'all in the comments is saying nothing. I don't know if y'all sharing. I don't know what y'all doing, but I hope you hear what I'm saying to you right now. I said that that devil was in the tree with a plan. All he needed was a womb. And so he began to speak to Eve. Eve, who had been partnered with Adam, so that they would bring forth and plenish the earth and do the things that God had in mind to be done. He seduces Eve to capture a womb, to be able to have a place to put the seed. And when Eve fell into the when Eve chose the seduction and ate from the tree, right? Then the seed of the adversary of God got access to her womb, which is why she gave birth not only to Abel, but also to Cain, because Satan got access to her capacity to imagineer. I said imagineer earlier, but I'm just saying it differently just for you to get a different picture. To imagineer, to take the adversary's picture of the kind of humans that he wanted to create and be a womb to make them material. Come on here and hear what I am saying. And so when we begin to get lured away because we don't have the mind that gives us the defense against a very seduction-laden climate that we exist in, then we become like that. We become hijacked. Satan hijacked the womb that was given, that was partnered with Adam, and it became his mechanism and his impetus for things that he wanted to push into the creation. It became the impetus for how he would roll his rule out onto the planet. It gave him access to the entire human legacy for him to begin to install the programming of those that would serve and be susceptible to his mind. Hear what I'm saying to you today. I gotta go. I'm so out of time today, but when we get in it real good, I can just go on and on. But I thank you for your time today and for tuning in to the Force broadcast. We'll continue with this more next week, but until then, listen, don't forget, you can go to www.price.university to learn more about our university, the educational opportunities that are there, credentialing, certification, etc. You can also book me. You want to partner with me? You want to have some mentorship? You would like to maybe you need some kind of these kind of insights in your ministry. Maybe you're a leader and you could benefit in this season from a prophetic watch care where a prophet partners with you concerning some things that you're walking through with your people and getting them from a point A to a point B, and you want to know more about, well, you know, what would that look like? And that's something that you would benefit from. You can go to the www.prophetic-ed.com to learn more about these things, to book an appointment with me, to set up mentorship or to set up a discovery call, for example, to learn about ways that we could possibly partner. All right, so listen, I'm so excited. Don't forget, you guys, our August issue of Force Magazine has been released. We have the featured enforcer, Apostle Dr. Roy E. Smith, and we're going to be doing a live featured enforcer chat. Guess what? We're going to be doing a two-part session with Dr. Roy. So look out for that information. And until next time, thank you so much for joining the Force broadcast. Blessings to you.